Hello student, today I am taking the class 10 social science geography chapter number 6 manufacturing industry. My dear students, earlier I explained you about the agriculture industries. Now today we are going to study about these mineral based industries. How these are set up in our country, what type of technologies we are adopted, what are the different methods we are adopted and how it helps to increase our economy. So what we will study today, mineral based industries like iron and steel industry, aluminium smelting, chemical industry, fertilizer industry. The next one is automobile industries. Next is information and technology and electronic industries. Now when we set up these industries, definitely they create pollution. So after that we study about what are the industrial pollutants, how they cause industrial pollution and environmental degradation. Then in this we will study water pollution, thermal pollution, noise pollution, and then how we can control this environmental degradation, what is the role of NTPC. So now today we are going to start what are called mineral based industries. Industries that use the mineral and metals as a raw material and then they produce something that is called mineral based industries. First we will take iron and steel industries. Do you know the iron and industry is the basic industries since all other industries, because do you know it is heavy, medium and light. It depends on it for their machinery. That is why it is a basic industry. Steel is needed to manufacture a variety of engineering goods. We need for construction materials, for the defense, we have to make different types of, and then medical, telephone, scientific equipments and a variety of consumer goods. That is why we all call it, it is a basic industry. Do you know production and consumption of steel is often regarded as index of the country development. Iron and steel is a heavy industry. Why it is called heavy industries? Because all the raw materials as well as finished goods are heavy. They are heavy and bulky. It entailing heavy transportation costs, because to transport from one place to it takes lot of costs. Do you know iron ore, coking coal and limestone, these are required in the ratio of approximately, now iron ore 4, coking coal 2:1. These are the ratio we are making for this. Do you know some quantities of manganese are also required to harden the steel. To make the steel hard, we are using this proportion, iron, coking coal and limestone 4:2:1, and some quantity of manganese we are added. Now do you know it is concentrated to close to rich mineral areas where we mostly get this Chota Nagpur Plateau region in West Bengal, Jharkhand and Odisha and Karnataka and Tamil Nadu. These are the places where we get this minerals in large amount. Now, but there are some factors, some of the factors which are responsible. Question come, why the iron steel industries are located in some area? Because it is mostly established where these are located. So what are the factors which are the responsible for the location of iron and steel industry? First one, close proximity to the area where the raw materials are found, and it will reduce the transportation cost. That is why these are located in the, established that places where these mineral ores are available in large quantity, because they have to take these raw material from the mines and it need to transport. So transportation need too much cost. So that is why they are mostly located where the raw materials are available. Second one, availability of the cheap labor. Can the labor will be available easily and in the cheap quantity? Second factor. Third, can there will be regular supply of water and power, means electricity. Next, nearness of the market is also essential, because when they finish these products, so can it be sold easily. So that is the next. Next one is, it is close to seaport. Why? Because when they complete these goods, then they will export these. So seaport is available, so that can export easily. So seaport is also close to the place where it is located. Now, when we are doing the process of how manufacture will be manufacturing of steel. What are the process by which we are preparing the manufacturing the steel? See, these transport of raw material to the plant. So in the blast furnace, big blast furnace, what they are doing there? Iron ore is melted. Here they are putting this the ores where they brought, and they are bringing that and they are putting in the big furnace. In this, limestone is fluxing, melted. When it is melted, fluxing, then material which is added is after that, when it will be melt, some waste material is come out, that is called slag. It is removed and coke is burned to heat the ore, because coke is required. How we can melt this? Now next, these are doing under the blast furnace. After that, what is called pig iron. Now the molten material poured into molds, that is called pigs. Means it is a pure material, that is called pig iron. Now shaping metals, what they are doing after this? Now this molten material poured into mold, then steel making. Do you know, the pig iron is purified. How it will be purified? By the melting, and then all the impurities that will be oxidizing, and then they are adding manganese, nickel, chromiums are added on it. So in this way we prepare the steel. After that, these steels are going to be shaping the metals. Now a sheet is prepared, they are making the shape. So shapes like they are rolling, pressing, casting and forging, these are the steps. So what are the different process of manufacture of steel? First, the transport of raw material from the mines they have taken. After that, these will be reached to the industries where they are putting this ore in the blast furnace, big furnace, because now the ore we had brought, there are so many impurities are there, so we have to melt it. So iron ore is melted, limestone with that, and then material fluxing, and the material which is added, so slag is removed, some materials are added, so slag means waste is removed, and coke is used for burn and heat the ore. After that, these are transported, that is called pig iron. Now in the here we are having molten material that is poured into mold, so that we call pig, that is why it is called pig iron. After that, now steel making, what happened? These pig iron, it is purified, again it is purified by melting and oxidizing. Why? Because so many impurities came, so that should be have to be removed, and they are adding manganese, nickel, chromium, all these are added. Now the complete steel is ready. Now the shaping the metal, now whatever the types of shape they have to make, so they are making rolling, pressing, casting and forging. In this way, this process of manufacturing of steel is going on. Next, still there are so many challenges for iron and steel industry. India is not able to perform its full potential in this industry is due. What are the challenges? Still, first, limited availability and high cost of coking coal. That is the biggest problem. Second one, poor infrastructure. We are not having advanced stuff. Next, irregular supply of energy. These are the some challenges that are. Other one is labor, low labor productivity. These are some challenges still behind. Do you know, we also import some good quality of steel from other countries. However, the overall production steel is insufficient because our domestic demands are not satisfied. Now, some liberalization and foreign direct investment have given a boost to the industries with the effort of private entrepreneurs. Now our government has done some liberalization. So in this way, now it helps the private entrepreneurs, so they can use their capital for manufacturing these industries. There's a need to allocate resource. Still we need for research and development, so we can produce steel more competitively. Now, so we had finished this iron ore. Now next, I am taking aluminium industry, aluminium smelting. Do you know, it is the second most important metallurgical industry in India. Why? And why we are using aluminium? It is light, resistant to corrosion, means when it comes in the moist air and water, it will be not corroded. Corrosion means jang lagna. And it is good conductor of heat. Malleable means we can beat with hammer, it can convert into sheet and become straw. How we will make it straw? When it is mixed with other matters. Do you know? It is used, where we are using this aluminium mostly, it is used to manufacture aircraft, utensils and wires. It has gained popularity. Why it is more? Because it is a substitute of steel, copper and zinc and lead in a number of industries. Aluminium smelting plant in the country where mostly they are located in Odisha, West Bengal, Kerala, Uttar Pradesh, Chhattisgarh, Maharashtra and Tamil Nadu. See, in 2008, India produced over 15.29 lakh million tons of aluminium. Bauxite, the raw material is used in the smelter, is a bulky, do you know, it is dark reddish colored rock, and the flow chart is given here, so we can see what are the process of manufacturing this aluminium. Do you know, regular supply of electricity and assured source of raw material at minimum cost are the two prime factors. These are the two prime factors for the location of the country. Now question come, if we may need 1 ton of aluminium, how we can make? See, 4 to 6 tons of bauxite, 2 tons of alumina, so it will make 1 ton of aluminium. Process of manufacturing aluminium industries. Now, see this, these are cryolite, bauxite, these are the raw material, and these bauxite raw material and bauxite quarry. Then these are transported by rail or ship. Alumina, do you know what happened? The bauxite are crushed. It is crushed and alumina dissolved out. Where it is doing? They are doing in aluminium refinery. After that, when it will be crushed and it will be dissolved out in aluminium refinery, then bulk are shipped to site of smelter. Means the amount that are shipped to site where the smelter is putting there. And they are calcinated, petroleum coke from a refinery, and third, pitch from a colliery. After that, this cryolite, a molten metal, act as electrolyte, then it will be sent to the aluminium smelter, and then aluminium smelter, do you know, when it comes, it needs electricity near about 18,600 kilowatt per ton of ore. So in this way, this process is going on. Next we are taking, that is chemical industries. The chemical industry is a fast growing and diversifying. Do you know, it contributes approximately 3% of the GDP. It is the third largest in Asia and occupies 12th place in the world in terms of its size. It comprises both large scale of industries and small scale manufacturing units. Do you know, rapid growth has been recorded in both, means inorganic and organic sector. There are two sectors, inorganic chemical industries and organic chemical industries. So these are inorganic chemicals. What type of here we are manufacturing the materials that are including sulfuric acid. It is used, sulfuric acid, where we are using, it is used for manufacturing fertilizers, synthetic fibers, plastics, some adhesives, paints, dye stuffs they are using. Next one is a nitric acid, alkalis, soda ash. Do you know, nitric acid, alkalis and soda ash, they are used to make glass, soaps and detergents and paper and caustic soda. Do you know, these industries are widely spread over the country. Question come, why they are fast and they are growing very fast and spread? Because organic chemicals, these include petrochemicals which are used for manufacturing synthetic fibers, synthetic rubber, plastics, dye stuff, drugs and all pharmaceuticals. That is why. Next, do you know organic chemical plants, where they are located mostly? They are located near oil refineries because it needs petrochemical. So they are located near oil refineries or petrochemical plants. The chemical industry is its own largest consumer. Now, basic chemical undergoes, what happened? The basic chemical, they are going in so many process to further produce other chemicals, and that is used for industrial application. It is using in the agriculture or directly consumer markets. That is why it spread very fast now. Next one is we are taking fertilizer industry. See, fertilizer industry is centered around, do you know, main is production of nitrogenous fertilizer. Mostly what it is used for agriculture, mainly urea. Next one is the phosphate fertilizer and ammonium phosphate, DPA. Now, and a complex fertilizer which have a combination of nitrogen, phosphorus and potash. The third, potash is, why potash is important? Because potash is entirely imported, as mostly it is imported as the country, and they does not have any reserve for commercial usable potash or potassium component in any form. Do you know, India is the largest producer of nitrogenous fertilizer. There are 57 fertilizers units manufacturing nitrogens. They are manufacturing nitrogenous and complex nitrogenous fertilizers, and 29 units for urea and 9 for producing ammonium sulfate. It as a byproduct, and 68 other small units that produce a single super phosphate. Do you know, at present there are near about 10 public sector undertaking and in one in cooperative sector. It is at Hazira in Gujarat under the Fertilizer Corporation of India. Do you know, after the Green Revolution, the industries expanded to several other parts of the country, Gujarat, Tamil Nadu, Uttar Pradesh, Punjab and Kerala. They contributes toward the half of the fertilizer productions. Other significant producers are Andhra Pradesh, Odisha, Rajasthan, Bihar, Maharashtra, Assam, West Bengal, Goa, Delhi, MP and Karnataka. Now next industries we are taking, that is called cement industry. It is essential, as you know, essential for construction activities like bridges, buildings, roads, dams, etc. and some other commercial established it needs. This industry requires a bulky and heavy raw material. Which type of raw material we need to make the cement industries? First one is the limestone, second silica, alumina and gypsum. And coal and electric power is needed, apart from and rail transportation need. See, do you know, the first cement plant was set up in Chennai in 1904. After independence, these cement industries expanded in our country. But due to decontrol of price and distribution since 1989 and other policy forms led to the cement industries, it makes rapid progress in the capacity, process, what type of technology they are adopt and how they produce. There are near about 128 large plants and 332 mini cement plants in the country. Do you know, the India produce a variety of cement. Now, improvement in the quality has found a produce a readily available market in East Asia, Middle East, Africa and South Asia from a large demand within the country. This industry is doing well in terms of production as well as helping export. Now, there are so many efforts are begin being made to generate adequate domestic demand and supply in order to sustain these industries. After that, now we are taking the next industries, that is called automobile industry. Do you know, the sector had experienced a quantum jump in less than 15 years. Why? Foreign direct investment, FDI, bought its a new technology and align the industry with global developments. The industry is located in India, where around Gurugram, Mumbai, Pune, Chennai, Kolkata, Indore, Hyderabad, Jamshedpur, Delhi and Bengaluru. Do you know, at present there are near 15 manufacturers of passenger cars, 9 for commercial vehicles and 14 of two-third wheelers. Now, next industry that is called information technology, IT and electronic industries. Do you know? It covers products from transistor sets to televisions, telephones, cell phones, telephone exchanges, radars, computers and other equipment that are required for telecommunication and computer industries. Bengaluru had emerged as an electronic capital of India. Very important, be careful about that. Other important centers of electronic goods are Mumbai, Delhi, Hyderabad, Pune, Chennai, Kolkata and Coimbatore. Next, we are taking the software technology. At present there are 46 software technology park in India, in which 30% where the women are employed. The fast growing BPO sector, business process outsourcing, it is a major foreign exchange earner for the country. Now, important IT centers where mostly they are located, they are Bengaluru, Noida, Mumbai, Chennai, Hyderabad and Pune. Next, now we have studied that there are these type of industries are here in our country. Definitely these industries, either we talk about the agriculture industries and this, definitely they will create some pollution. So pollution which is creating from the industries, we are calling it industrial pollution, and how they affect our environment. See, so industrial pollution and environmental degradation. Industries have contributed significantly to India's economic growth and development, but the waste products contain some airborne particles, matter. Basically, industries which are responsible four types of their pollution they are creating: air pollution, water pollution, land pollution and noise pollution. What is an air pollution? Do you know it is caused by the process of high proportion? Do you know when sulfur dioxide, it will be increased. When high proportion of sulfur dioxide and carbon monoxide increase in the air, it causes air pollution. And it is emitted by chemicals. From where it is comes more? It is emitted by chemical and paper factories, brick kilns, refineries and some smelting plants, and where we are burning the fossil fuels in big and small factories. So it causes, you know, when these are mixed in the air, it causes so many respiratory problems. Next one is the water pollution. It is caused when organic and inorganic untreated waste material that is discharged directly into the rivers. So they create water pollution. What type of products? Dyeing, petroleum refineries, tanneries, electroplating industries. These type of industries are the main industries which causes water pollution. Do you know what they destroy? It is threatened to plant, aquatic and human life. All the aquatic creatures will be affected by these water pollution. Next is the thermal pollution. Thermal means heat. This occurs when hot water from the factories and thermal plants is drained into rivers and ponds. Before cooling, they are directly sending this warm water. So waste from the nuclear power plant, nuclear and weapon production facilities cause cancer, birth defects, miscarriage, and they destroy all the aquatic creature, flora and fauna. All will be destroyed due to this thermal pollution. Next is the noise pollution. Noise from industrial sectors, construction activities, machineries, from the equipments, they are contributing noise pollution. This type of pollution, you know, noise, it causes so many problems, result in hearing impairment, increase heart rate, blood pressure and some physiological effect, even psychological effects also. So question come, how we can control this environmental degradation? First, minimizing water usage by reusing and recycling waste matter water in two or more successive struggles. Second one, rainwater harvesting to water requirement. treating the hot water and industrial waste before releasing them into river and pond. So in this way we can save them. This can be done in three phases. How we can do? Primary treatment, secondary treatment and tertiary treatment. Primary treatment means by mechanical means. We can do screening, grinding, flotation and sedimentation. By this so many heavy materials will be settled down. So in this way we can save. Next, secondary treatment. By the biological process, such as we can plant trees, rainwater harvesting method we can use. Next, third is the tertiary treatment. We can add some chemicals, do some physical and biological process by which we can recycle the wastewater. So by these, when we adopt these three phases, so we can control this pollution. Next, some general points to minimize environmental pollutions are: overdrawing of groundwater resource by industries need to be regulated legally. Now nowadays all are using this underground water. So what happened? The underground water which is stored, it is used. So that should be minimized. Next, generators and other machinery should be fitted with silencer. So what happened? It create large noise. So we can reduce the sound. Next, particulate matter in air can be reduced by fitting. Means in the factories we can fit some smokestacks with some electrostatic precipitators, fabric filters, scrubbers and internal separators. When we put this, so we can reduce this air pollution. The challenge of sustainable development, it requires integration of economic development with environmental concerns. Means we can only use those materials we can save the our environment and reserve for the future generation. Next, NTPC. NTPC is a major, what is the role of this NTPC? It is a major power providing corporation in India. It has ISO certification for EMS, Environment Management System, 14001. See, the corporation has proactive approach for preserving natural environment and resource like water, oil and gas and fuel in place where it is setting up their power plants. This has been possible through how? First one, see, optimum utilization of equipments, adopting latest techniques and upgrading existing equipment. So in this way we can save. Next, minimizing the waste generation by how? Maximizing gas utilization. Means we can burn it and then we can use this. So in this way we can reduce these waste material. Next, providing green belt. How? For nurturing ecological balance. Means addressing special purpose for vehicle for afforestation. Means we can plant more and more where is a wasteland we can make plantation. Next, now it is finished today. Now I had finished this manufacturing industries. Now we have studied the agriculture industries and mineral based industries. What are their contributions for the development of our national economy? What are the different factors which create problems and what are the methods and which are the organizations which are doing some efforts to control these pollutions? Thank you.